The point is, like, each compartment of your life has its function, you know, and this lifetime is a kind of compartment. You know, we existed before birth. Birth is when we took on this body. And after death, when we leave this body, we will still exist. Existence doesn't change. It's the expression that changes. And, you know, I still miss certain aspects of my father. You know, certain things that we had, I miss that. But I also know that he's doing what he needs to do right now. I don't feel like he's missing or that he's gone and disappeared. And in the ER, you know, I don't talk philosophy, but I try to convey that sense that, you know, there is a meaning, there is a purpose, there is a sense in which things are okay, even when a loved one is passing away.
I'd like to welcome to the show Dr. Anoop Kumar. How are you doing, Dr. Anoop?
I'm doing great, Alex. It's great to be here with you.
Thank you so much for coming on the show, my friend. I'm really excited to talk to you about your experiences in not only your near-death experiences, but your experiences in spirituality, your upbringing, so on and so forth. But you are an ER doctor having a near-death experience, which is very interesting because you're not, you know, lack of a better word, foo-foo and all of this and kind of like, you know, oh, the crystals and not that there's anything wrong with that. Everyone listening, please leave the comments alone. But, you know, you're not the classic metaphysical person. You're a very logical, at least in your everyday life, very logical, very down in the material. So it's really fascinating to see where this all goes. So my first question to you, sir, is what was your life like before this near-death experience, your first one? You had two, if I'm going to say, or it was just one?
I would say it was one that was kind of like a blowout, and then there have been kind of, you know, different blips.
Aftershocks, little aftershocks.
Yes.
Got it.
Yeah. The aftershocks continue, but...
Got it.
Before that, so that was actually in medical school. Mm-hmm. In my kind of mid to late 20s, I think later 20s is when it happened, when I was in medical school. Before that, you know, I was growing up, I was immersed in spirituality, in Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta, or the philosophy of non-duality, which is getting very popular these days. Mm-hmm. My parents were very much into that. Our family was. So as a kid, that felt like my first education, actually, you know, because we would go there on the weekends. We would be there during the week and sitting in on the adult classes, talking about mind and the nature of reality and the purpose of life. And I loved it. I mean, it just made sense to me, you know, not that I understood everything intellectually, but it seemed relevant. Let's just put it that way. And then I'd go to school and sit there and I'd be like, I don't know. It just did not seem so relevant, you know, to put it mildly. And of course, now I know it's because school, they look at everything on the objective side of it, but they forget about the person who's looking at it, which is like insane, you know? Whereas this was, no, you have to look at everything together and specifically look at the lens that you're coming from. So that's how I was going about my life. And I found school very dissatisfying, including medical school, to be frank, to the way we looked at the human being, the way we looked at the human body. And so there was this restlessness in me, you know, there was this kind of searching, even though it wasn't formalized as to like, you know, what is this? What is this about? You know, kind of like, where was I before? What is after? Like, what is this stuff? So I was always experimenting with my mind and doing little exercises, like standing right next to the wall and seeing what it felt like to like be through the wall and just always playing around with stuff to try to figure out or experiment with and come to rest. Come to that state of rest and peace. You know, so that's what it was like before, even though it wasn't a formal process. I'm not even sure I was aware that I was doing that, but it was just that restlessness was there until things kind of opened up.
So what happened on the day of your near-death experience?
So that day I had come back from med school and I was at my parents' house and I was in my bedroom and I was reading. And reading some philosophy, actually. It wasn't medical related. And I read something, I don't remember what it was. And in that moment, it felt like a huge explosion went off. You know, it just felt like everything blew to smithereens, so to speak. And it felt like I was sitting in the sun. And, you know, it's funny, Alex, I've said this so many times. And every time I say it, it's so strange how I can't say it any other way. Like, it just seems so true. Like, I was sitting in the sun, no matter how bizarre that seems or how whatever it is, that's what it was. There was no body, there was no world. It was just sun and me. And I was part of the sun in a sense. And it was blissful. It was perfect. It was timeless. It was all the things that we always hear, you know, those kinds of things. And I'm not sure how long that went on exactly, but I remember then feeling like I'm going through the sun or beyond the sun. And it got to this place where I had 1 foot beyond and 1 foot still there in this brilliant orange blaze, this mother of all blazes, right? And just when that was going to happen, just when that was going to complete, let's say, then this flame arose within this brilliant blaze, that's the sun, this secondary flame arose and instilled this thought in my mind, which is that this wouldn't be fair. And it's not yet time. And, you know, like when you hear something that's so true and so deep, you know, it doesn't require any force. It just makes you stop. You know what I mean? It freezes you. And this froze me. It made me pause, even as I was about to take that step beyond. And I knew if I took that step, that was it. I was not coming back. It was not, you know, that was it. Which wasn't a bad thing, but it is what it is. But when this being put this idea in my mind, it was just so true. I knew it was so true. And I think everything that remained to be done, the strength of that karma, you know, those rubber bands that keep us wherever we're supposed to be, they snapped back and everything re-imploded. And there I was sitting with that body in that same room, and just, I remember kind of looking around and being like, almost like, what is this? I thought I knew this place. But I could see in that moment that I never really knew what this actually was. And it was so crystal clear that our world, I'm just going to use a word, light, that our world is made of light, is constructed out of light. You know, that space that we consider like space between our hands, that there is light here. It is light that is appearing as space. It's not an emptiness, you know, and that what we call hands or objects are modifications of that light, densities, different kinds of densities. And I sat there for some period of time. I'm not really sure how long I sat there. And then I got up and started exploring. And I remember going to the bathroom and looking in the mirror. And what struck me about that was I didn't recognize the guy in the mirror, because that guy looked too peaceful, you know? And I had this restlessness in my body before, which I can't say that I was ever too conscious of. I mean, I kind of knew that I was on some kind of search maybe, but I could only realize how much tightness there was in the body when it was gone. And when I saw that guy's face, and I was almost like, you know, I would like to know this guy. This guy looks, you know, much more relaxed, much more content. And that was the beginning of everything, a long process of integrating that continues today.
Why do you think this happened to you? Because it seemed that you were on the path. It wasn't like you were like, you know, I'm going to go be a basketball player. Yeah. But your path was to be a doctor. Yeah. It wasn't a kind of like a wake-up call or anything. Why do you think it happened?
Well, you know, I could not have communicated all they have communicated in the last 15 plus years if it were not for the clarity that has come from that. You know, so much clarity just came in to my life and continues to come into my life. And so much assimilation and integration and healing, you know, of my traumas from this lifetime, from other lifetimes, you know, my relationships, karma, you know, there's so much, you know, it's not just like somebody has an experience and that's great, but, you know, like, how do you live that in your life? And how do you spend the rest of this lifetime? And what is the meaning and significance of that in the space of all lifetimes? that we experience, you know? So all that, there has to be some clarity to communicate about this, I feel like. And especially as an ER doc, I feel like I have a responsibility. I diagnose emergencies, right? And I treat emergencies. So I think the biggest emergency is that we have forgotten who we are and we don't really know what this world is. That's the emergency. And the heart attacks and the strokes and everything come downstream from that. As a result of that, there's so many steps in between that leads then to these kinds of diseases. And for me to speak about that coherently and clearly and with compassion and love has been a process, you know? So I feel a responsibility there, and I don't think I could be doing that without the clarity that has come with that and beyond.
So when you were on the other side, did you have, you, there wasn't a traditional life review, there wasn't spirit guides, there was just this being, this fire being, if you will, who...
Yeah, it was just this blaze. And I suppose this secondary blaze that came up and put that thought in me could be thought of as spirit guide who said, hang on, don't go out that door just yet, you know?
But let me ask you this, because from my experience of talking to so many near-death experiencers, that each one is tailored for the person and at the stage of where they are. Yeah. Why do you believe that this was the best way to communicate to you, and it wasn't, you know, Shiva didn't just show up, or Buddha showed up, or there were, you know, you were in a field of grass. Well, why do you believe it was a ball of, I mean, this is the first time I've heard this ball of fire, coming from my recovering Catholic background, a ball of fire, not a good thing when you die. not as much from your background, but from my background, you die, you're like, oh man, fire. Oh, what did I do? So why do you think it was that the way they did it?
Well, so for whatever odd reason, I wouldn't call it fire. I would call it like a blaze, like a brilliant orange blaze of, I would say, like pure knowledge and pure love. Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe one of the reasons it didn't come in the form of Shiva or something else is because I had explored those things. I had been immersed in that since I was like 8 or even before that. And I'd been heavily exploring that. I'd been doing meditation. I had thought about the nature of reality, about what Shiva represents, both in body, as a supernatural being, as an extraterrestrial, as a consciousness, a formless consciousness. So I had explored a lot of these, you know? So if something like Shiva had shown up and told me something, I would have been like, cool, that's really cool. Like, but that wouldn't impacted have kind you. Of done it for me in a sense, you know? I would have been like, okay, but what's beyond that form, you know? So I think for me, it was like an intense window and even a chance to, in a sense, leave the game, you know? But then making a choice, I feel like I made a choice saying, no, I see, I get it now. And I see, even though I didn't think about all that at the time, but later in retrospect, I made a choice and I saw, and now I feel like I have a responsibility, you know, as difficult as it may be to communicate this stuff and still work in the ER and still trying to present a framework that's understandable, you know, that's what I'm going to do till the day I drop dead. There's no doubt about that. So I think I got just what I needed to give me that taste and say, okay, let me try to convey this.
So when you, when you're done with this experience, you're in medical school. How old are you? You're in your what, 20s at this point?
Late 20s. Yeah. Maybe 28, 27, 28.
So you had this experience, you walk out. I'm going to assume, and please correct me if I'm wrong, that when you discuss this with your family, they were open to it. It wasn't like a complete off, you know, out of left field kind of thing. But I'm talking about, how about your friends, colleagues? Because as I always say, these kind of stories clear the room if the room is not ready for it. So how long did you take before you did come out of the NDE closet, if you will? What and how did people react to it? And how did you deal with how other people reacted with it?
So here's the funny thing about that. Is that I don't know that I told anybody about this for like 10 years or something like that.
Right. Okay.
And here's the reason why. It wasn't because I hesitated. It wasn't because I was worried about what people would think. It's because I had heard for my whole life that from people who had dedicated their lives to this, experienced these things and so on, teachers, that Such things happen. You know, you have these experiences, you have these blowout experiences, you have these mystical experiences. Don't take them too seriously. You know, they're part, it's what happens. It's part of the journey. Integrate it and keep moving. And so that was my approach to this. You know, as much as it did, especially soon after that, I started my residency training in emergency medicine, which was nuts. And it, that was incredibly difficult. But even then, I hardly talked about it. I had a teacher in the area near Philadelphia who I would go to once in a while and be like, you know, I used to think like this, and I used to be considered a really smart guy, and I used to think in this way. That's not happening anymore. Like those thoughts aren't happening. And he was basically like, yeah, that's never going to come back. Don't worry about that stuff. You know, he would just have these very short redirecting answers. And because I trusted this person, that helped me. And even to him, I never talked about this, about what actually happened. So for me, like, I guess in my mind, I had always had that perspective that it's not, don't give it too much importance. And once I started talking about it, like 10 years later or so, what I realized is that this is actually a way to get people interested and start learning about what is possible. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's when I started talking about it, and I started to realize, oh, okay, I talked to the IANS, International Association for Near-Death Studies, and I think the president said, okay, what you had is called a near-death-like experience because your body actually wasn't. So I started learning all this terminology, and that's when I said, okay, I am going to start talking about this rather than just talking about consciousness, because sometimes it can be too abstract. So I started telling my personal story as well.
It's interesting because, I mean, your training in your past, as far as how you grew up and you were raised with all this information and like all the studying that I've done, we're both at a place where if something like that happens to us, we're kind of prepared for it. And I understand the point of view of the man that, or the person who was helping you along the path to go, oh yeah.
Yeah.
When you read autobiography of a yogi or you read the yogic philosophies, this is just everyday stuff.
Yeah.
It's just like, oh yeah, I was in the Himalayas and Mohita Babaji showed up and built a crystal castle and and he brought somebody back to life who jumped off of a cliff and this kind of stuff. Like these are stories that are built into the fabric of these kind of teachings. But for somebody in the West to have mind-blowing. So it's really interesting to see how you processed it. It wasn't as much processing as it was just like, okay, it's part of the path.
Part of the path. And it's like, to me, what it was and what it still is, that integrating is still happening. It's finding that middle frequency, right? There's that frequency where everything is kind of consciousness, let's use a word consciousness, and malleable and in the realm of possibility and light. And then there's a world of density and materiality and subject-object interface and you and me and these kinds of things. And so what I'm trying to do is kind of do this, right? Bring one up a little bit and maybe tone one down a little bit and find a language to communicate there, which is what I think is really important, rather than making something super extravagant and totally different out of this world. But then on the other hand, something else that can't be communicated at all, you know, and needs to be put in certain words. So that's really what I'm trying to do in the communication. It's not easy, especially if you want to honor science, which I do, if you want to honor philosophy, if you want to honor, I think most of all, we have to honor our day-to-day experience. So if you're listening and you're eating a sandwich, we have to honor that. That has to be included in this, right? It can't be like a philosophy that lives on a shelf or a spirituality that happens only during meditation. You know, that's what I think is really important. And I think that's the time we're in now, because I know you're into this as well, a place where what we used to call spirituality gets so wide and so big that there's no such thing anymore. It's just life seen at greater depth.
Did you have any other after effects in your body or in your perceptions or in your abilities after you came back?
So I should say that immediately afterwards, for some period, it was actually okay, because I think it was getting towards the end of medical school. The rigor had gone down a little bit. It was set. And then it really flared when I started my training in emergency medicine, when I, you know, moved to Philadelphia and then started seeing gunshot wounds and stab wounds and heart attacks and all this kind of stuff. And I was so sensitive to so many things that it flared. That's the only way I can say it. And so, for example, I found it very difficult to stay with the body. I found it very difficult, like almost like it was like a toaster oven. It was just getting too hot. And like this thing could not contain me. Like I wanted to blow up out of it. That happened a lot. So I would describe it as just very intense, you know, almost painful in a sense, maybe not quite pain, but almost that, like, you know, like stretching
uncomfortable
stretch. Yeah. And you're at that end of stretching and it's that, it's kind of like that.
So you're tapping out, you're starting to tap out.
Yeah. It's like, I don't know if I want this much. So it's kind of like that feeling was there. And many times I was out of the body, even while working in the ER. I became very sensitive eventually to food, the kinds of food I ate. I became sensitive to everything, you know, the colors, the foods, the kinds of people around me. All of those things started to kind of take on a greater level of meaning in my life.
How did you protect yourself from that? Being an ER doctor, you can't not see gunshot wounds and stab wounds and heart attacks on a daily basis.
And so the thing was that the answer wasn't to not see those things. The answer was to see those things more and more and more deeply, right? So that's what initially the tendency was. It's to kind of create this force field and not be exposed to this. But then what I had to do actually was open up more and more of myself and see into this person and see into this suffering and see what is happening in this wild, wild society that we're living in, and then meet it and try to say something with it or try to do something about it. So that's really been the way to me. The more I tried to block it out, the more intense my own energy became. And it's like, it would like work against me. But the more I just opened to everything, including to this person, I mean, I can't tell you the number of lessons I have from patients. I get them all the time from patients.
Sure.
Hey, I'll tell you one. Can I tell you a story real quick?
Sure, please go for it.
It was a lady who said, I had to put what's called a central line in her. So that's when somebody needs like heavy duty medications, and the typical peripheral IVs that we place are not enough. So you have to put a large line that approaches the heart for them to get these medicines. So I'd done that. And then she had asked me, she said, okay, I think it was in my last year of training. So she said, are you going to stay around here? You know, this is like Philadelphia in the city, inner city. You're going to stay around here? Or I said, well, I'll probably move back to the suburbs, you know, where I grew up and stay there. And she goes, yeah, you all just train on us and then you leave. You know, and that like, that hit me like a hammer, like a sledgehammer, you know? Why? Because just like that being who said, you know, it's not fair, it's not time. It was true. Mm-hmm. It was true. You know, like I had the choice to leave that place with gunshots and stab wounds and all those kinds of things. And she didn't. That's where she lived. Those were her circumstances. So stuff like that would hit me over and over. And I had to open more and more and more to that rather than, you know, try to force field it away.
I have to imagine as an ER doc that you're going to see some death in the AR. How do you, first of all, how do you see death now from your point of view? And how do you process it being as sensitive as you are to these kind of things? Yeah.
So my father died 3 months ago.
Sorry about that.
The way I see death after my experience seeing it in the ER with my father, you know, and I don't mean to make this too casual, but I'm just trying to give a sense. You know, we're doing this interview right now. After you do this interview, you'll probably leave the room that you're in and go to another room. Mm-hmm. And anybody who expects to see you live only in this room where you're doing this podcast right now, it's going to be like, oh, what happened to Alex? You know, he's not here anymore. I wish I could see him, you know, but you're on your next place. You're doing what you're doing next, you know? And I think there's so much confusion about death and fear around death that I wish that we could get the message out that what we call death is a change. It's like going from one room of the house to the other. You don't do in the living room what you do in the bathroom, hopefully. Right.
Depending on how many drinks you have, sir.
You don't do in the bathroom what you do in the kitchen. And the point is, like, each compartment of your life has its function, you know, and this lifetime is a kind of compartment. You know, we existed before birth. Birth is when we took on this body. And after death, when we leave this body, we will still exist. Existence doesn't change. It's the expression that changes. And, you know, I still miss certain aspects of my father. You know, certain things that we had, I miss that. But I also know that he's doing what he needs to do right now. I don't feel like he's missing or that he's gone and disappeared. And in the ER, you know, I don't talk philosophy, but I try to convey that sense that, you know, there is a meaning, there is a purpose, there is a sense in which things are okay, even when a loved one is passing away.
Now, I have to ask you, though, when you came out of the NDE closet 10 years later, you're a doctor. Doctors are, and please forgive me, not known to be the most open-minded folk on the planet. I have many doctors in my family, so I know this from my own experience. How did your colleagues deal with you talking about this so openly and freely while still practicing medicine? Because there's a lot of brave doctors after they retire. I've spoken to many of them, but while you're still in the weeds, how do they deal with it?
I think most just ignore it. You know, it's like anything else, right? So if you're talking to somebody and you say something that's off the wall and that they can't quite process, they'll probably just like kind of move on. They'll be like, all right. So, you know, you want to go get a drink or something? You know, they'll just kind of tune it out, right? So I think most people do that because if you take in what I say about, let's say, for example, the primacy of consciousness, it can turn a person's life upside down. It can make them think about things they never wanted to think about. It can make them feel emotions they suppressed decades ago, you know?
Yes.
That's what it takes to assimilate this. And so most of them just be like, all right, so, you know, what do you think about that kidney infection, you know, or something like that? But I will tell you, Alex, though, many of them come to me privately.
Yeah.
I've spoken to ER docs. I've spoken to surgeons. I've spoken to psychiatrists who've been like, well, you know, this kind of thing is happening. I don't want to talk about it publicly, but, you know, it's like it makes so much sense what you're saying. So many conversations like that. And that's why I'm talking more and more about it publicly, because I feel like if I can be the so-called strange one, if I can take that heat to be strange publicly, so to speak, I think there's so much relief in so many people that I will never know, you know, but they see that and they feel so much relief and they feel like they're normal. And so I talk about mental illness. I talk about so many experiences I've had. If I didn't know how to talk about it, if I didn't have the background in Advaita, if I didn't have the guidance, I could have gotten 20 diagnoses, you know, but I was very fortunate to have so much training, so much guidance, and so much knowledge as a doctor too, to know what do I say to whom, you know?
Now, we did talk originally at the beginning of this conversation about these aftershocks, these kind of other little mini NDE-like experiences. Can you talk a little bit about those?
Well, I would say after that, there were many different like spurts of openings, as tends to happen in these kinds of experiences where, you know, like I talked about, it's about this, but sometimes you do a little bit of blowing the top off some more. You know, so some were in the ER when I remember one lady took my hand and she said, "You are so loving." She told me, "You are so loving." It's one of the most touching moments in my career, and everything just turned to light. And I don't remember anything more. It was like Men in Black where they zapped the person and like, you don't remember anything more and just went to light. That was one of them. Many times when I'm sitting alone, these openings would happen. Sometimes I would see things like guides who are giving me messages. You know, sometimes I feel like I would be transported to other worlds and I'd be experiencing and learning and then coming back here.
Well, stop there for a second. Can you go deeper into that experience? Because that's interesting.
Yes. So I've talked about this a little bit before where I remember traveling to what I would call a crystal city, a city made of crystals with beautiful geometry, pyramids, a lot of circular or spherical, non-cornered edges. You know, in our world, it's a lot of 90 degree angles. If you look all around us, it's 90 degrees everywhere, you know, which represents a certain kind of thinking. Like you go this way and it's either this way or that way, you know, highway or the highway. You know, it's kind of like, it's this kind of thinking that we are memorializing in architecture. But there's spherical architecture, pyramidal architecture. Everything comes from one source, in a sense. These are the ideas that are kind of baked into this kind of architecture. So seeing this, seeing my relationships in other lifetimes with other beings, seeing myself as a woman, seeing myself as a different race, seeing myself traumatized, seeing myself killed. Once I remember riding a motorbike and approaching what looked like an angry group of people that were not looking upon me favorably, and basically them taking me down off the bike and starting to basically kill me, like beat me up.
Is this another life?
Yes. Yes. This is what I interpret as another life. Somebody will say it's a dream. Somebody says it's a vision. This is, for me, it's another lifetime, and trauma from that lifetime has come into this lifetime and was affecting me in this lifetime. So here I actually had a guide with me who kind of took me aside. So as it was happening, we moved to the side and we're watching it from the side, right? So my identity shifted from the guy that was getting beaten up to the witness on the side of the road. And we were standing there and looking at that. And so then I remember he said to me, all that's done now, you know, don't worry about that. And he said, let's go to the stars. And then we rose up and went into the sky to the stars. So many, many experiences like this, a lot of them having to do with healing. You know, for me, I feel like I take this, I'm very human person like everybody else. And yet I also take this, like, I want to do the best I can, you know? And so that requires a lot of work for myself, you know, and not taking things for granted. Like, there's still a lot of healing to do. There's still things to process. There's still relationships to nurture. You know, there are karmas that are coming in. There's the whole ancestral lines that are coming through. There's so much happening. And I have a lot of gratitude and respect for that, you know? So I still try to work on that even as I communicate. And fortunately, some of these experiences are helping with that.
As a doctor in this life, that's not an accident. So you are a healer in this life. It sounds like, as part of your karma, you are healing others in the physical standpoint, but you're also trying to heal others in the spiritual standpoint as well through your experiences. But it seems like this is a job that you have to do in this life, karmically based. Is that a fair statement?
Yes. I mean, absolutely. This is what I'm here for. And even to the point now that I don't see a physical world and a mental world and a spiritual world and an energetic world. I think, you know, we create labels, you know, based on what was given to us by the adults in our lives. It's that simple. You know, what they saw and that culture is generally what's given to kids and what kids kind of repeat until there's a insight that comes through. And then we have a chance to redefine and reestablish a new baseline, you know? So I don't see it now. No longer do I see it as like an ER doc who's treating physical things. And then I'm also doing spiritual stuff. Like, no, like, you know, what I'm doing is seeing myself more clearly. And so seeing others more clearly. And so seeing this world more clearly and trying to articulate that clarity and create a space for that clarity.
Would you agree that the more self-awareness and clarity that you have within yourself, the clearer so many other things in your life become? Career, relationships, money, just living life on a daily basis, things become so much clearer. Because I could tell you from my journey, as things started to clear up, I started dealing with traumas and releasing things. You become more, and meditating a lot, you become more peaceful. You become more, you don't get riled up as nearly as easily as you used to. Yeah. Things that would take you months to deal with before, you do in minutes now. Yeah. If not instantly. So yeah. Do you find that as well in your experience?
Yeah. Self-awareness is really to me about depth and range. And so there's a depth to it where we see a situation, but now we see so many layers of it, right? So why is it presenting this way? Why at this time? How did it come to this place? How did I contribute to this? You know, these are all the layers of any situation that's happening. And that's depth, you know, and then there's range like beyond this physical world, this energy world, you know, this planet, you know, this Milky Way, this cosmos. So there's that range. And those two aspects, those two dimensionalities of awareness, I think can heal anything. I mean, if your awareness can open enough to be able to sit with something, right? I mean, what do people do in therapy? Isn't it essentially being able to sit with what's actually going on without having to react or run from it, right? It's awareness. And so the more we can do that, yes, absolutely, the more knots come untangled, the more relationships find an equilibrium wherever they need to be, rather than kind of manhandling the relationship. So yes, I agree with you.
Yeah, that untangling is a great analogy, because, you know, we're born with a certain amount of knots, but then we add a whole bunch more as we grow up. Our parents add some, our community adds some, our religion adds some, our countries add some. Everything starts to add up to the point where you're just this ball of knots.
Yeah.
And I think that meditation does begin to loosen those. And it also brings some of the knots that are really deep in up to the surface, so you can begin to unwind them, even though you might not really want to. And sometimes you're terrified to. It's like one of the old sayings, like the most terrifying thing a man can do is look in the mirror. Because it is, I mean, you and I've already had that dark night of the soul. I've already kind of done that. I feel very comfortable doing that. But man, it was terrifying at the beginning. It's terrifying. Would you agree?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And if you look at yourself in the mirror once a year, every year, you'll see a different person each year. It never ends, you know? So like, you know, it's funny, in culture, there are certain words, right? And especially in spiritual culture, there's enlightenment, there's dark night, there's NDE. You know, you can probably name like 5, 6, 7 terms that come up a lot. But then what happens when all that stuff is kind of done? Like, you're not done. You're just at a place where we don't really language that well, you know, where we don't really talk about. But if you look in the mirror there, it's still something new and different. And 5 years later, it's still something new and different. And you're getting to a place now where English isn't enough. You know, there are no real words to capture some of those things. So I agree with you. Like, looking in the mirror is, it's like looking into the depths of the galaxy and the cosmos, you know, where you have supernovas and pulsars and you don't know what's going to come up.
And when you believe that you are just this body, getting a glimpse of that is terrifying.
It can be.
But if you understand that you are God, you are source energy, you are all of this, you are the cosmos, you are every, then that doesn't seem as scary to you.
Yes. Yeah. In fact, it feels right. Like, it feels like home. It feels natural. It feels a state of ease and seamlessness, you know? And like we said before, if a person takes themselves to be a body primarily, there's a reason they do that. It usually comes from the adults in their life when they were children. And there's usually a ton of fear around that, about what would happen if you believe differently. You know, there's usually a lot of confusion around that, like intellectual confusion, you know, not accounting for, like, you have to discard science and discard reason. And you just have to believe this, you know, don't question it kind of thing. There's so many things that one has to come up against and resolve to just even let yourself go and enjoy that.
How do you balance the material world, which you are engulfed in every day as an ER doctor, and this spiritual world? Because when you're fixing a gunshot wound, I'm assuming you're not meditating on it. You're actually doing some physical stuff to stop the bleeding. You know, like I always say, like, you know, long-term medical care, they might not have it as well as the East does sometimes, long-term. Yeah. But if I'm shot, don't rub a leaf on me.
Yeah. For you, I'll bring a leaf, Alex.
I mean, if they don't rub a leaf on me, you know, like, no, give me the pain meds. Do what you gotta do to get me back up. But so the balance of both is such an interesting balance that you do. How do you do it?
Yeah. I don't see it as both.
Okay.
That's how I did it, you know, is that to me, it's one seamless world, whatever we want to call it. I don't see, even science tells us that when you go past the smallest things, right? So you have hand, Then you have what? Molecule, atom, protons, neutrons, and then you get down to elementary particles. And then what are those tiniest, tiniest elementary particles, like an electron? What are those made of? Oh, they're actually vibrations in infinite fields of energy. What?
With a lot of space.
The smallest things. Yeah.
With a lot of, yeah.
The smallest things are made out of infinite fields, right? It goes against, that's what I was talking about, the confusion, the intellectual confusion that we're born with. We think things are made from smaller things. And it holds true, but once you hit a certain level, they say, well, not so true. Actually, they're made from the biggest things, right? So once you get to that level, the whole idea of materiality goes out the window. What we call materiality is sensation, right? But if you're in a dream, doesn't it feel just as physical? And when you wake up from that dream, what's the difference between the physical and the mental world? It's simply a shift in consciousness from what we call the dreaming state to the waking state. And the exact same true is here.
I don't know about you, but I've woken up in the morning and my wife is hitting me. I'm like, what? She's like, you were cheating on me in my dream. I'm like, are you out of your mind? She's like, it felt so real. I'm like, I'm not doing anything. What is wrong with you? So yes, to prove your point, sir, absolutely. Like, something happens with someone you want, and you're like, you wake up like, I can't believe that person did that, but they didn't. It was in my dream, but you felt it.
Yes,
at really deep level.
Yes, right, and so. These things are all happening at some level, different densities. You know, that's why even hallucinations, you know, I don't feel I have the authority to tell anybody, hey, what you're perceiving is not real. I don't know. I'm not the expert on reality to say that what you're experiencing is not real. What I can say is I don't experience what you're experiencing. Now let's talk about the meaning of what you experience, because we're already at the point where neuroscience is telling us that this is a co-constructed collective hallucination, right?
Yes.
So at some point, I think it's just a matter of honesty. Let's just be honest. Like,
well, let me ask you this, because you and I both are fans of Yogananda, Paramahansa Yogananda. And in that book, Autobiography of a Yogi, that book will blow most people's heads off if they're ready for it. But this idea of the yogi, this idea of the spiritual masters of the East, and it's not just India, but in many other countries as well, but we'll use India as an example. There is a lot of confusion about what a yogi is, or what they have achieved.
Yeah.
From your experiences, both pre near-death experience situation and after, what are these ascended masters once they leave this planet, become ascended masters, but these walking masters at the time, which there are walking masters currently on the planet, what are they doing on a cosmic spiritual level, from your own, if you can explain that from your experience.
Sure. So a simple principle in this universe is that everything affects everything, and that at a fundamental level, there are no impermeable boundaries, right? They may appear to be, you know, of course, there's a boundary between, let's say, my body and yours, boundary between this finger and my hand. There are these, but once you start zooming in and really looking, all boundaries start to really become permeable and eventually disappear. So what we call boundaries are, let's say, ways of perceiving, all right, or shared notions. So everything affects everything. So if you put hot water and cold water together, what do you get? You get warm water, because the two kinds of water affect each other, right? If you get two people together, one is really anxious, one is really calm, you might get something in between, right? So a yogi is no different than anybody else in that sense, right? They affect the things around them just like all of us do, just like everything does. You turn on a light, the room gets illumined. The light affects the room. The difference is with the yogi is that they're aware that their boundaries are all permeable, and they can function beyond the boundaries of a person who has not realized this, right? So their activation, their capacity to influence goes far beyond that of another person that has not yet moved through their boundaries. And that's simply the difference. And so what seems like a great distance for one person is nothing for a certain kind of yogi, because they've realized the nature, the reality of consciousness, and how space and time are structured in consciousness. And so it's simply a matter of switching attention. You know, 1,000 miles is a matter of switching attention rather than getting on a plane and traveling 1,000 miles.
Which is what I've heard so much in near-death experiences. People who are on the other side, they think of a place and they're there instantly.
Right.
But here in the density of material of the material world, it takes a little bit, it's a little bit heavier lift.
It's a little bit heavier lift, and depends what you want, how much you want to take along with you. Do you want to check those two bags, or can you travel lightly, you know?
Right. So, so what you're saying is also explains a lot of the mystical yogi power or the yogic powers of levitation, of biolocation, of ashes coming out of hands, and all this stuff that's been spoken around, or being not eating for you know, very little, or not sleeping for 5 days, and you know, these all these kind of things is they've become masters of the physical form. Yes. And have now been able to transcend the physical form while still maintaining the physical form. There's stories of Yogananda when he used to go meditate. He's like, I'm going to be gone for a while. If you need me, just whisper quietly in my ear and I'll come back. But he'd be gone for 2 or 3 days in meditation.
Yeah.
And he'd just be in the cosmos, hanging out, doing his, what I guess what spiritual masters do. I have not partaken yet. They haven't invited me over yet. But but it's these kind of ideas are fascinating, and they are ancient. This is not new age by any stretch of the imagination.
It's old hat, and you'll hear it over and over in every culture, pretty much.
Right. Versions of it, you know, of it. I mean, you can go into when Jesus started creating miracles, it sounds very yogic.
Yeah.
A lot of the stuff that he did.
It is yoga. I mean, it's 100% yoga. You're dealing with the energy body and how, like we talk about boundaries, right? The usual boundaries aren't there. So the influences can be there. And by the way, that can go both ways. So somebody who's experimenting in certain stages can also be adversely affected because there is a certain skill that's also involved there. Otherwise, if you just open up all, we have boundaries for a reason. Let's put it that way, right? If you just open up all your boundaries, you can also be influenced and take on things that you don't know you're taking on. So it works both ways.
Have you ever been able to diagnose something with more of an energetic interpretation, or is it always physical? Because there are doctors who I've spoken to who had near-death experiences who then came back and go, oh, someone's telling me this, or I felt this, and the diagnosis were almost always right.
You know, not in the ER, in the sense that, so I like to talk about the difference between a patient and a person, or a doctor and a person, right? So everybody is a human being at some level. And then on top of that, we take on certain roles. So one person may be in the role of a patient, one person may be in the role of a doctor, right? So in that certain role, I have a certain training, right? So I'm trained in biomedical science and that whole process of taking a history and physical exam and all that. That doesn't really have to change when I see a person, right? So, but what I can bring is like my intuition, my awareness, my knowledge, like those things can be there underneath. But in the ER, that usually in making a diagnosis, the kinds of diagnoses we make in the ER, that usually doesn't come into play because the diagnoses that we make are hardcore physical diagnoses. It's like there is a blockage in the vessel to your heart. I can do an EKG and see that right here, right? Or there is an infection in this area. I can do a test and see that right there. But where it does help is saying, how did it get to this? So, you know, what's going on in this person's life that is representing itself in the physical sense as this, right? So if there's a blockage in this heart here, what is the blockage that's representing itself physically as this, right? So I get to have those conversations, which is very meaningful with people.
Would you agree that the body is a representation of what the knots that you're dealing with in life, the baggage that you're bringing in, people who get diagnosed with a certain disease, or some of it could be karma, obviously, but, you know, just, I've just found out that you know, I was talking to someone who had a past life, past life regression, and they always had a problem with their shoulder. No reason for it, just had they couldn't get it to work properly. That was always off. And he has this, that goes into a psychiatrist's room, and they have a recession, a past life regression. And he's on a battlefield as this, it was a woman, giant, Scottish Viking-esque kind of dude. And he took an axe to his shoulder. And that's been brought over from another life. So that's one example. Other ones are like moles or deformities in the body. Could be a bullet hole, could be a stab wound. And you're like, why is that scar there for no reason? I was born with it. Would you agree that that is a representation of past lives, of current life, and what is actually happening in your life? If you're holding on to a lot of anger towards your parents or trauma, it can manifest into cancer or something along those lines.
100%. 100%. And it's not just the body, it's everything physical. Anything that we call the physical world is a kind of energy. It's a kind of something that has happened, something that we believe that is representing itself that way. Look at something simple, even like soap. If you have soap in your shower, it simply means that we believe in cleanliness. We believe that some things are dirty, some things are clean, and we have created this tool to kind of make ourselves that way. So everything has meaning, you know, and there's nothing. And that's the difference between something like allopathy, which is what I practice, and some of the other traditions like Ayurveda or like yoga. They look at the meaning, they look at the mind, they look at energy and how it then constitutes the physical structure, right? I think it was Wittgenstein who said, the body is the best picture of the soul.
Mm-hmm.
And I agree with that 100%.
What is your biggest takeaway from your near-death experience, liking near-death experience, like experience?
Consciousness is fundamental. Consciousness is fundamental. It's the brain doesn't create consciousness. The brain doesn't sit alongside consciousness. No, the brain itself is an image in consciousness. What we call the brain is a partial representation of the mind. And that's why the brain lights up when the mind is thinking. It's not that the brain is causing the mind, because when the brain goes away and stops, guess what? That mind keeps going. It's that mind is not dependent on the brain. It's dependent on the brain to express itself in a particular way. And that's how it shows itself through that brain, through that body. But consciousness is fundamental. The entire physical world is a vibration and structured in this infinite field of consciousness. And therefore, each of us is boundless. Each of us is infinite. In our deepest nature, we are infinite. And we can have this tremendous experience of experiencing boundaries and relating with each other in this world.
I'm going to ask you a few questions to ask all my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Being myself.
If you had a chance to go back in time and talk to little Anoop, what advice would you give him?
Do just what you're doing.
How do you define God or source?
This.
Just this.
Just this.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Being yourself.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world, sir? Hopefully they don't need an ER situation. Other than the ER situation, I don't want to see you in the ER, sir, because that's a problem.
Right.
Outside of your ER work, sir. Let me clarify.
So myself and a friend, we have co-founded a company called Health Revolution. And this came out of, I was talking about consciousness a lot and the three minds framework a lot. And ultimately I felt like I was leaving my patients behind because a lot of them didn't have time for this or they had more pressing issues, so to speak. So I said, I have to bring this down to earth in terms of health. And that was the impetus behind Health Revolution. So healthrevolution.org is where we are. We have bi-weekly webinars that talk about health in so many ways, talk about consciousness in so many ways. And we have a 28-day jumpstart program, which is what I love so much, because this is a way for a person who really wants to know what health is, right? Not just the blood pressure, but health in every sense, at every level of being. This is a 4-week, 28-day program to help a person understand and experience what health actually is. It's all at healthrevolution.org.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
I love you. Thank you for being here on this journey with me, and I hope to meet you soon.
My friend, I appreciate you and what you're doing for the world, my friend. Thank you again for coming on the show and sharing your amazing experiences and knowledge with all of us. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Alex.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.